Hi everyone and welcome to a new video. In this video, I am discussing why it might be a good idea for you to move from Windows to Ubuntu or some version of Linux. Why this was suggested to me and a bunch of sort of very smart coding people in IIT Roorkee in our first semester, why we were actually forced to move from Windows to some version of Linux, and why it has become my primary operating system over the past few years. And the speed that I've gained while I code is sort of compounded over the years thanks to me moving from a Windows based machine to a Linux based machine. Let's get right into the video. So as I said, in my first semester, me and a bunch of people joined a coding group, and we were all forced in the first semester to move from Windows to Linux. They said we wouldn't let you inside the lab unless you move to Linux. The reason was whenever you're building real world applications, right, and you're deploying them on the internet, for example, if you ever see a website, the website usually isn't running on your machine. It's running on a machine somewhere else. Windows was built to be a very nice and strong GUI system for normies, for people who don't want to code. So there are a bunch of buttons there and like flashy UIs, which are great if you are an operational person. If you want to spend your time inside the general explorer, use Excel, things like these. That's the primary sort of operating system. That's the operating system I used until I was in my first semester. All the games I had installed were in Windows and I was generally very comfortable with the OS. Moving from that to this ugly looking Ubuntu thing was definitely a paradigm shift for me, and I did not understand the need for it until 6 months after I did it. What was the need for it? As I said, what are you doing when you're coding? You're mostly creating and deploying apps on the internet. What does deployment mean? It means you're creating a website and some code you're putting somewhere. This code, the place where you put it, right, is usually not your own machine. And one very common example I want to give here is, it might happen that during the day, your website goes down for some reason, and then you need to find the issue and fix it. The problem is, how do you connect from your machine to that machine where your website was deployed? I'm going to repeat this. Your website is not deployed on your machine, on my machine here in Dubai. My website, if I have one, is deployed somewhere in the US, let's say. It's running on a computer there and something went down. I need to now fix that thing. How do I fix it? I need to basically connect to that website in the US. And if it was running on a Windows machine, there are multiple problems that come. One, I need all those colors, all that GUI sort of streamed to me, and then I need to move my pointer and finally fix the thing that I need to. What if there was a what's called a command line way for me to access the file system there, make the changes, look at the bug, and then fix it and come back? Let's get into some coding and understand what I mean by all this. Some of you maybe have seen this black thing called terminals that a lot of hackers use when they're coding. This is a place where you can run a few commands. What is a command? Basically, run something and it'll give you an output. I ran pwd, it gave me the output, which is the current folder I'm in. What does this mean? If I open my bin folder, I'm in the bin folder. Similarly, this terminal is currently in /users/Harkirat. From this terminal, I can navigate to various folders. From this terminal, I can navigate to, let's say, a folder that I have. Let's open this folder. Now I can explore the folder. For example, what files are present here. And if I have a bug in my website, let's say, I just need to connect to the server there and make the right changes and deploy the fix. Let me show this more practically. Let me actually connect to a server that I have running in the US, not here. The way to do that is you create what's called a SSH session or a secure shell session from your terminal to that terminal in the US. If I run this command and press enter, then you can try this not just here. You can, what we did in college was, when I got a friend's laptop, I put some code there that would let me at any time from my hostel room connect to his laptop. I repeat, you can actually do this. I would urge you to Google, maybe I'll sort of give a hint in the end. You can, if you have your friend's laptop, just once put some code there and in the future create such secure shells to their machine as long as you're on the same network. And if you can do that, since you have access to the complete file system of that user, you can basically do a bunch of things. So you can pull their photos out, you can pull their cookies, log in into their Facebook, so on and so forth. I wouldn't recommend you do it, but this is a way to do it. You cannot do that. You cannot create like a Windows session to them and see their screen. I mean, you can do that as well, but much harder to do that, much easier to do this. Also, another very big benefit that this gives you is, if you have 5 developers on your team, let's say, and something went down on the server in the US, all 5 can connect to the same server using this thing, because this has no mouse pointer, this has no flashy sort of animation or GUI that one person can only see at a time. This is a secure shell. It lets you send some code there and it gives you an output, and multiple people can do this at the same time. This is not possible in a GUI, because where will the mouse pointer be? Will it be where I am moving it or where the other person is moving it? Hence, What is the other benefit of a bash? It's a very simple interface for you to explore everything on the machine that's not yours by connecting to it. And that is super powerful, not just to hack your friend's machine, but also when in the real world you're deploying applications. This is 99.9% of the times how developers connect to remote machines, which is why it is good for you to do this locally as well. This terminal that you see on the right is my own machine where I have a folder open. If I spend a lot of time in this terminal, which means run a bunch of commands here and maybe even code here, if in the future there is some issue here, there, I need to edit a JS file here, a JavaScript file. I can't really open the JavaScript file in VS Code here. This is not a GUI. VS Code won't open here. Any IDE won't open here. I have to make those changes using this thing called Vim, which is one of many sort of GUI editors that lets you edit files. So if I SSH into this machine, I can't open this code in VS Code, which if that is my primary way of coding, that is how I usually code when I'm coding locally and I don't code here. This is just installed for the course. If this is the only way you've coded, if there is ever a bug, you won't be very fast here. You don't need to be very fast here. Usually when you SSH into a machine, you just look at the bug, then you fix it locally and push it. But it is good for you to spend as much time as you can, which means not just exploring the file system and running commands, even maybe writing code in the terminal, which is sort of something I'm doing as well. And you can do it very well. There are like very nice editors today. For example, if I open a JavaScript file here, I can see the standard sort of color coding and even other things that sort of GUI editor gives me. Of course, it is not as powerful, but it is extremely powerful when it comes to you being fast. It's extremely customizable, which is something even I am learning, but I can tell you that by default, terminals give you like very bad output. If you open sort of, if you run a simple command here, you see like no colors or very minimal colors, but this is highly customizable. You can move from this to like very well color coded files with sort of line numbers here because of how customizable the terminal is and how many tools people have created on top of it. So you don't have to create these tools. There are very nice tools available out there that gives you, even though the terminals are meant to be black and white and simple colors, they give you like very nice, almost GUI like apps. So if you spend the time, some time, which for me just to install Neovim on my machine was almost 2 days, and now learning has been a challenge in itself because I was very comfortable not with VS Code but with WebStorm, which is also a GUI editor. It does take time, but that is how you learn. So I would strongly suggest you start at this point just exploring the file system and at least running some commands here. One small example can be when you're pushing code to GitHub or generally interacting with GitHub, try to do everything with the terminal. GitHub gives you a GitHub CLI, which I'm seeing a lot of people use when they're creating open source contributions, but it also gives you a very nice CLI. I would prefer, or I would urge you guys to use the CLI rather than using the GUI, which I'm sure it is great for beginners. But again, this is how you sort of start to chew glass and learn. Back when I was coding, I wasn't allowed to use GitHub's GUI. I think it did not even exist back then. Now it exists, so they've tried to make it easier for normies, but you want to move from being the normie category to the developer category. So one example is running GitHub commands. You might ask Harkirat, why do I want to learn, run whatever this 4-line command when I can just click a button in a GUI? I would say yes, you are right here. You just have to click a button there. But there are like, as I said, bash is really powerful and you can make it very powerful for your own use cases. For example, in my case, if I run this command gh2, it does the same thing as git push origin master. Where have I defined this? I've defined this in a file where I've created a bunch of aliases for pushing to various remotes. You can do that as well. You can customize it very well. And once you've created your own system, which could be yours, or you can also copy other people's, people have sort of open sourced them on GitHub. I'll link a few in the description. And you get used to writing code like this. I don't think there's any going back. There is always a learning curve, but I've always seen from my college, I knew smart people were telling me move to a Emacs or to Vim. They're very powerful. I did not. After 5 years of sort of graduating from college is when I sort of saw one of my coworkers in the US be extremely fast in this. I realized how powerful this is. And now I'm sort of pushing myself to learn this. If you're at stage zero right now, which means you're on Windows, the least you can do is at least move to Ubuntu, start working on the ugly GUI. I know it takes 6 months to get used to, or it feels like someone has put you in like a very old house, but it doesn't really matter. Most of your time you either spend in the terminal coding or in the browser, which are the same on both Windows and Linux. If you're still in double minds, you can do one of two things. You can either dual boot your machine, which means you can have both Windows and Ubuntu, so you can switch between the two. Or you can install this thing called WSL, which is Windows Subsystem Linux. It lets you access this thing, the bash, and run these commands on a Windows machine. That's sort of the primary purpose of this video, for you to spend more time in the terminal. But if you can completely move to Linux machine, there are benefits there. Maybe not as much if you're working in the terminal all day. feel free to keep Windows, but at least start getting comfortable with the bash. If there's a GUI application for something and CLI, try to use the CLI as much as you can. What are examples? Examples like this. And once you're doing all your things in a terminal here, for example, I'm starting to code here, I can sort of install Neovim on a remote machine as well. So if I actually want to code on the remote machine, I can do it. And I have all the systems sort of to do the same things that I'm doing here. Here, I have the same sort of, I just need to copy a few bash files here. And that machine behaves just like my local machine. You cannot do that through GUI. So this was a very small video where I wanted to share. If you're on Windows, try to move to Linux. Either way, please spend a lot of time in the bash. I'm going to link a few assignments in the description. That will hopefully be helpful. Just try to force yourself through all of them and try to finish them. There will be really nice prompts. So if you don't understand something, try to ChatGPT it. But hopefully by the end of all of these assignments, you should be able to at least start navigating the file system, running basic commands. And after that, it's just how much time you spend there and how much you hustle. With that, let's end the video. I'll see you in the next one. Bye.